Hello, everyone. I'm Phil Cardoso, and I'm an assistant professor here at the Department of Animal Sciences at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. So I'm going to be sharing with you some of the presentation that I gave at the Dairy Summit during January 22, 23, and 24. I'm going to talk a little bit about my background. So as you guys notice, my accent has a little bit of southern intonation, and that's because I'm originally from Brazil. And as you guys can see, I'm originally from South Brazil, but throughout my vet degree, I had the chance to visit the U.S. several times. So I've been to California, I've been to Illinois and Wisconsin as well. And I had the chance to experience so many different dairy systems where I would go to California, I would be fascinated about the large farms, but also fascinated about the family farms at Wisconsin and Illinois, where I could interact with the farmers directly. And that gave me a lot of insights on how those veterinarians and that vet practice, how they would work with the farmers. So, like I said before, I'm originally from South Brazil, where we have some subtropical weather. You can see in the north part of the map, it's really hard to have some hostings and jerseys because it's too hot. So they have to crossbreed those breeds with Bos Indicus. And here in the US, Brahman is the name of the breed. So they have to crossbreed Brahman and hostings, for example, so they can support the heat. However, in the south part that you can see in pink, we have the subtropical weather where we do have pure breed cows, hosting cows, Jersey cows. But like I was mentioning, through all my visits in the US, I had the chance to then learn a different way to practice veterinary medicine. And Brazil was really common for the veterinarians to go to the farm and ask the farmer what they should be doing. And actually, here in the US, they were doing totally the opposite. They would go to the farm and be ready with the numbers and everything that was necessary to then do the work and to see the opportunities at the farm. So that's why I built up my own practice in Brazil. And you can see in those pictures some of the common farms where they would have some time on pasture, but also they would come after milking to headlocks, where they would be fed some TMR with corn silage, sometimes ryegrass haylage, and concentrate as well. So here you can see a very typical farm where cows are grazing. So you can see in the dark green, the paddock where the cows are on. And that paddock could be enough for one day or sometimes half a day. It would depend on how much dry matter that paddock would be offering through the pasture. In the right side, you can see there is this light green. There was the paddock the cows were in one day before or half a day before. So as you can see, there are a lot of changes in the fiber content of the material those cows are eating. And especially when the transition from summer to winter, where the grass variety would change, those cows would not have enough fiber in their diets to function well, to have a good ruminal function. So those cows would experience DAs, displacement of abomasum, a very common metabolic disorder that happens after calving. Because that was so constant and farmers, they usually didn't know what to do. Some farmers, they would just have cows dying their farm because cows would not be being diagnosed with the disease. I came back at some point to my former university and did my master's degree on DAs. And here you can see two cows. And look at the picture below that you can have such a difference in grass, like the paddock above, much more fiber, much more contact than the paddock below. So for those of you that never heard about DAs or displacement of abomasum, and that was the focus of my research, imagine a cow at this position that we are seeing here in this slide, and I'm going to do a cross section in her body. So we should be seeing the left side, the rumen of the cow, and in the right side, in the bottom part, you can see the abomasum. So I'm looking from the tail to the head of the cow. That's what we call a caudal view. And this is what happened when cows displaced the abomasum. They calved, they're not eating enough to fuel the rumen. What happens is that the rumen gives space for that abomasum to displace. And unless you do a surgery or there are several other approaches, but if not treated, cows can die. And oftentimes when I was talking to the farmer during the surgery, I would always ask to the farmer, so how is your dairy business doing? And oftentimes I would get the answer, what kind of business? So farmers, often they were not understanding their farm as a business. So I thought that was a good opportunity for me to move to another university as a research assistant, and where I could develop some tools to try to get things done at the farm. As an example, we would separate farms by sectors. Just like when you go in a big company, in a big industry, big factory, you see different sectors. We divide farms by the reproductive sector and also the milking sector. And here is a way to understand. So this big plate would be placed after the milking parlor or close to the milking parlor. And here you can see that farm would be milking 2 times a day. And after each milking, in each day of the week, they would take the filter from the machine and place it in there. So when that farm faced some big problems with somatic cell count or even bacteria in the milk, that was an easy way to say that, for example, on Wednesday, the second milking was much more clean than the first milking. And you know that preparing cows to be milked, cleaning the teats before you attach the milking units, that's very important to avoid cross-infection and mastitis and to lower somatic cell count. So that was one of the tools that I would be using to make the farm understand and all the employees to see where is the problem and how can we work to get better results. After that, what happened is that I felt the necessity to multiply this information. So I felt that it was really important to change the dairy industry, and I thought that the best way to do it is being a professor so I could multiply the information through the students that I would have throughout the years. So I came to Illinois in 2009 and did my PhD with Dr. Drakely on transition cows. So this was our main question. How can we help this cow, a cow that just calved and is passing through several metabolical changes? And the main objective, if you ask yourself, if you ask farmers, if you have producers, consultants, veterinarians, that's the main goal. You don't want to have sick cows after they calve. You want them to be producing as much milk as they can. And of course, you want them to get pregnant, because all this means more money in the farmer's pocket or more profit. So the classical transition period that we have from 21 days before calving and 21 days after calving, by the presentation that I'm going to be talking next, managing the transition cows, my suggestion is that we should be looking at the 3R transition period. This is a concept that I'm going to further develop. That is, throughout my research, I've seen that depending on what kind of diets we are using during the dry period, that has an effect on reproduction. And actually, if we add milk production after calving plus reproduction and measuring those results, that's, I think, what we should be looking at the transition period for those cows from the dry period until they get pregnant. So this would be the 3R transition period of a cow from the dry period, 3 weeks before calving, until she gets pregnant. So we developed an online platform that you guys can reach at dairyfocus.illinois.edu. That's the main webpage that you guys are going to be receiving information through the media library, but also a newsletter. We are also on Facebook, where we're going to be posting events or meetings or any new information that you all can also be looking at. Thank you for your attention. And the second part of this video, you can find in our webpage, podcast, or YouTube channel. Thank you very much.